Really have been uneasy all week as far as exactly what the Lord would have me preach today in both the services and in the men's prayer, to which I have already, men's brotherhood, whatever, that I preached at another church. But I am settled that the Lord would have me preach from Colossians chapter 1 this morning. But I would like to do with Colossians, it's such a short book in mine. It's about 3.5 pages in my Bible. I'd like to read the entire book, and then we're going to settle back in, Lord willing, on the first few verses of chapter 1, and then this afternoon, we're going to let the Lord lead. I think I know what I'm going to preach, but I don't want to tell you now in case he changes my mind. Here we go, Colossians chapter 1. Give me just a second here, got something on that one. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother. To the saints and faithful brethren in Christ which are at Colossae, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which ye have to all saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which is come unto you, as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you, since the day we heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth. As ye also learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ, who also declared unto us your love in the Spirit. Verse 9, for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom, the Son, we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who, the Son, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature, for by him were all things created. In other words, the Son created all things that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and by him all things consist. Or in today's language, they continue to exist. Verse 18, and he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. In other words, remember from the 70s and 80s, those Jesus first pens. Christ should be first in all things. Verse 19, for it pleased the Father that in him should all the fullness dwell. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. In other words, if you're still living today and you get to go to heaven, it'll be by what Christ did on the cross. And anybody who is in heaven today, whether it be Adam or Seth or David or whomever, they are there because of what Christ did on the cross. Verse 21, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy, that's set apart, unblameable, without sin, unreprovable in his sight, if ye continue in the faith grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel, which ye have heard, and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, am made a minister, who now rejoice in my sufferings for you, and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you, to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, which now is made manifest to his saints. Those are believers. Verse 27, to whom God would make known what is the riches of his glory, of this riches of the glory of this mystery among Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach. What do we preach? Christ. Whom we preach, warning every man, teaching every man in all wisdom, that's Christ's likeness, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus, whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. Chapter 2, for I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of full assurance of understanding to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and the Father and of Christ, in whom are hid all treasures, in whom in Christ are hid all treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And this I say, lest any man should beguile, lest anybody should trick you with enticing words, for though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I present with you in spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him, in Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And ye are complete in him, in Christ, which is the head of all principality and power. Verse 11, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, in putting off the body of sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. In other words, when we came to know Christ, we didn't have to physically cut ourselves. Baptism had nothing to do with our salvation. We are baptized in obedience to Christ. But when I accepted Christ as my Lord, then he circumcised my heart to make me a believer in him. Verse 12, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead. And you, being dead in your sins and the circumcision of your flesh, in other words, in our own works and in our own sins, we were dead. He hath quickened together with him. He's made us alive, having forgiven you all trespasses. Verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it away, praise God, nailing it to his cross. In other words, before I got saved, my sins, CJ, were written in the book. And there's all this condemnation against me. All this condemnation against me is written in the book in heaven. But when I called on Christ, boom, he threw it away because he nailed it to the cross and it's gone. Amen. Verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it away, nailing it to the cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, that's Satan, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of an holy day or of the new moon or of the Sabbath, which are a shadow of things to come. But the body is of Christ. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of the angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up in his fleshly mind, and not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment, ministered and knit together, increasing with the increase of God. Let me just hit that for a second. There's this mentality, okay? And people call it legalism. Okay, I'm going to read the rest of this thing in a minute, I promise. But people call it legalism. And the funny thing is to me, I know people who, from either extreme, you can be a legalist and not have, help me Lord, the convictions of dress or the convictions of which translation is best or all these. You can still be a legalist over there. You can be a legalist over here. You can be a Pharisee, because both the Sadducees, they were theologically liberal, and the Pharisees, theologically very conservative. Both of them were legalists, trying to do things by the law. We're not saved by the law. This whole yin-yang thing, y'all know what the yin-yang is? I don't see any heads rattling. The yin-yang is that little, I think it's a Chinese or a Korean emblem, and half of it's like a teardrop that's black and half of it's a teardrop that's white. That's a worshiping of the flesh. If I can live, then they say that the spirit is good and the body is evil. So if I can live in the spirit, then I'm going to do only good things. If I satisfy the body, then I'm going to do only bad things. Listen, the body is evil. You'll find with every heretical lie, there's an element of truth. The spirit, if you're born again, is good because it's of God. And the body is evil. Paul said he crucified himself daily, moment by moment. The flesh is evil. But we can't worship our deeds, be they good deeds or evil deeds. The only way we are sanctified, the only way we're saved first and then sanctified, and the only way we can serve is by Christ Jesus. It's not according to works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy hath he saved us. And remember, that's about getting saved. What about service? Philippians chapter 2, we've preached through the book of Philippians for those that are not aware. In Philippians chapter 2, it clearly says that if we do something right, or if we desire to do something right, it's God working in us. Everything is about Christ. Verse 20, wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are ye subject to ordinance? Touch not, taste not, handle not, which are all to perish with the using, after the commandments and doctrines of men, which things have indeed a show of wisdom. They look smart in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. If then ye be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection, set your love. This is a determination. Set your desires, if you will. Set your affection on things above, not on things on earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ. When Christ, who is our life, remember we preached that from Philippians, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. Mortify, kill, murder, kill, mortify, therefore, your members which are upon earth. Fornication, that's sex without a marriage contract. Uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, covetousness, which is idolatry. See, all these ungodly things, is we're putting them before God. They become idols to us. For which thing's sake the wrath of God cometh upon the children of disobedience, in the which ye also walk. So don't get your head all up in the air like you're something perfect. In which ye also walk sometime when ye lived in them. But now, praise God, ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man. You see, some of it comes natural by salvation, and some of it's personal determination to put on the things of God, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. That's Christ. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision or uncircumcision, barbarian or Scythian, bond or free, but Christ is all and in all. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering. Show me arrogance anywhere in that we're supposed to put on. Verse 13, forbearing one another, forgiving one another. If any man have quarrel against you, if he's got an argument against you, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And above, hold on, let me hit that for just a second. When did Christ forgive you? On the cross. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When did you get the benefit of that forgiveness? When you ask him. So in other words, Fudd, we're supposed to forgive people before they ask for it. And then let God handle when that relationship is restored. Let's continue reading. And above all these things, put on charity. This is agape love, the love of God, which is the bond of perfectness or completeness. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also ye are called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatsoever ye do, in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and Father by him. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service, not when they're looking as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. In other words, serve your master like you're serving the Lord Jesus. 23, whatsoever you do, do it heartily, as to the Lord, and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward, the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of persons. Chapter 4. Masters, give unto your service that which is just and equal, knowing that ye also have a master in heaven. Continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving, with all praying also for us, that God would open to us the door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am also in bonds. I'm in prison for preaching, but pray the Lord would open the door for me to preach more. Verse 4, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak, walk in wisdom toward them that are without, walk in Christ-likeness towards the lost, if you will, redeeming the time. Verse number 6, let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. In other words, don't just let the first thing that comes in your mind come out your mouth. Let God control it. Verse 7, all my state shall Titius declare unto you, who is a beloved brother and a faithful minister and fellow servant of the Lord, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that he might know your estate and comfort your hearts, with Onesimus, a faithful and beloved brother. Onesimus is a runaway slave that got saved in prison, by the way. We'll get to that soon. They shall make known unto you all things which are done here. Aristarchus, my fellow prisoner, saluteth you. Marcus, sister's son to Barnabas, touching whom ye received commandments, if he come unto you, receive him. And Jesus, which is called Justus, who are of the circumcision, these only are my fellow workers unto the kingdom of God, which have been a comfort unto me. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. For I bear him record that he hath a great zeal for you and them that are in Laodicea and them in Hierapolis. Luke, the beloved physician, and Demas greet you. Salute the brethren which are in Laodicea and Nymphas and the church which is in his house. And in other words, Nymphas is a pastor. Verse 16, and when this epistle is read among you, cause that it be read also in the church of Laodicea, and that ye likewise read the epistle from Laodicea, and say to Archippus, take heed to the ministry which thou hast received of the Lord, that thou fulfill it. The salutation by the hand of me, Paul, remember my bonds. Grace be with you all. Amen. Written from Rome to the Colossians, and it was sent there by Titius and Onesimus. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for your word. There's so much meat and milk in nearly every verse of this scripture to make us more like thee, Lord. I pray as I try to preach the text you've laid on my heart from this book, that you would make it powerful to the refreshing of the saints and to the redeeming of the sinners. For it's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen. If you look here in the first few verses of chapter 1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ which are at Colossae, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. There is a message in the introduction. What was Paul's given name? Say again. That's right. Paul's given name was Saul. So when we see that name, Paul, we know he's been born again. Okay? That's the first thing. That's the first step anybody needs to grasp, is what it means to be born again. Christ Jesus came not into the world to condemn sinners, because we were already condemned because of our unbelief. He came in to give us life. And there's so many different ways to say it, but we need to grasp that everyone needs to be saved. And for those people that are here this morning that may not know for sure, let me explain it one more time. In order to be saved, it's not going through the baptistry. It's not signing a card. It's not turning over a new leaf. I used to be a drunk, and now I'm going to go to AA meetings, and I'm going to change my life, and so I'm saved. It's not. I mean, I have heard people give as testimony of salvation the fact that they were about to die and God spared their life. That may be a saving of their flesh, but that is not salvation. Our current president said, in the context of, have you ever been born again? Have you ever been saved? Have you ever asked God to forgive you? He said, Fudd, I've never asked anyone for forgiveness. That's not salvation. In order to truly be saved, Miss Christie, we have to understand God loves us. And most everybody in here can quote the verse, for God so loved the world. Okay, but it doesn't get real until we understand, for God so loved. John Stuart Hallman, born the 2nd of May, 1968, into the home of a freshly saved man named Grover Stuart Hallman. I didn't get saved, even though I was born into a Christian's home, actually. I didn't get saved until I grasped that love for me. I have to understand that he loved me. And we could go around the room, and if I knew who all might listen to this by internet, I could call their names, because we all fit into the world. For God so loved Andrew. For God so loved Gemma. For God so loved Tiffany. For God so loved... what's your husband's name again? I'm just kidding. Channing. For God so loved Kendra. For God so loved Chris, who's at work today. For God so loved every one of us. We have to grasp he loves us. But though he loves us, we are separated from his love by our own sin. The scripture says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. If I compare myself to Fudd, I'm going to come out on top, because I'm going to pick his weak points and my strong points. If I compare myself to Charles, I'm going to come out on top. If Charles compares himself to me, he's going to come out on top. But when any of us compare ourselves to Christ Jesus, we don't come close to adding up to his glory. But just knowing that he loves me, my sin separates from me. That's not enough to get saved, is it? We have to understand that sin has a salary. The wages of sin is death. And that's not talking about just a physical death, though that physical death is wrought in that. But God told Adam in the garden, if you eat of this, thou shalt surely die. But did he die physically that day he ate of it? He did not. But he did die spiritually. The death he's talking about here is the second death. Death is separation. Somebody asked me at that other brotherhood thing this morning if my grandpa had been killed in a wreck in the Amory area. And I'm like, no, my dad was killed in a wreck between Belmont and Fulton. So using that was brought to mind today. Boy, who my daddy was not in that casket. That was just his earthly tabernacle. But Miss Tiffany, October 6, 1967, he knelt down between the handles of, we would say, a wheelbarrow. But my papa and my papa both said wheelbar. And he laid his Bible between in the bucket of that wheelbar and called on Christ to save him. So he's not suffering that second death. Sure, he suffered a violent physical death in that car wreck. But who he is, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord if you're a believer. Now, we apply that to just about anybody that dies, but really, if they've not come to know Christ, that doesn't apply to them. To be absent from the body is to lift up your eyes in hell. That's the second death. Christ preached twice as much about that as he did about heaven. But if we don't come to know Christ as our Lord and Savior, we will spend eternity in hell. And some people might say, Dockery, that I'll get out a little while for judgment. No, the Bible says death and hell delivered up the dead. So from hell, they will recognize Christ as Lord. But there's no break from it. So we have to understand God loves us. We have to understand that our sin separates us from that love, and that sin has a salary, which is eternity in hell, separated from God. Get back to the good news. The Bible says in Romans 5:7, for a good man, some would dare to die. But 5:8, but while we were yet sinners, enemies of the cross, Christ died for us. No, I didn't quote the whole verse, but those last four words, I hope I never lose the power of that. Christ died for John Stuart Hallman. Christ died for Johnny Irvin. Christ died for Charles Marshall. Christ died for Karen Sims Marshall. Christ died for Michael Grimes. Christ died for Christy Sims Grimes. We could go all the way around the room, and to anybody who might be listening, Christ took your place on the cross. You racked up the debt of sin, but he willfully took our place on that cross. And if, according to Romans chapter 10, if we believe that in our heart and we call on him with our mouth, he'll save us. Didn't say maybe, didn't say possibly, but he said he'd save us. Now, there's a problem that we have to get into real quickly. The Bible clearly defines different types of belief. If I truly call on him, my life is going to change. Some of it's going to change instantly, and some of it's going to change incrementally over time. But you need to understand, just because somebody repeated a prayer and signed a card does not make them a believer in Christ Jesus. The Bible says clearly that faith without works is dead. The Bible says clearly the devils believe and tremble. Read the Gospels for yourself sometime, Mr. Brother Eaton. No devil ever comes in contact with Christ that he didn't recognize who he was. Jesus, thou son of David, what have I to do with thee, one devil said. They all recognize who he is. They all will eventually submit to his authority. But just because you know who he is, and one day you will submit to his authority, does not make you a believer in Christ Jesus. And then we talk about Abraham's faith, how he believed God and it was counted unto him for righteousness. And then we saw that, did he live a perfect life? No, sir. But we saw that he started to follow God. His life changed. Paul went from persecuting the church. And the Bible says, Ashley, immediately after he got saved, he was found in the temple preaching. And I'm sure all of his changes didn't come immediately, but there were some changes that were clearly evident from the moment of salvation. Paul was saved, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Apostle means sent one. If you're saved this morning, say amen in a loud voice. Amen. You are sent ones. Now, you may not, you're not an apostle in the way that Paul was an apostle and the other 11 were apostles. They were apostles because they saw Christ in the flesh. They were apostles because they spent 3 years with him. Paul clearly talks about having spent 3 years in the desert and was an apostle born out of due season. As near as I understand the scriptures, and I wouldn't argue with you over it, but as near as I understand the scriptures, Christ came back and spent 3 years with Paul in the Arabian desert and taught him all things from Scripture, and that's why God was able to use him as he did. Okay? We're not that kind of apostle. It is not biblically correct to call ourselves apostles today. It always bothers me. You see these preachers on TV, and he says, apostle so-and-so. He ain't spent 3 years with Christ. Not in the flesh. However, if you're born again, you're sent. You're sent to tell others what great things Christ did for you. Look, not only that, look to the next verse there. To the saints and faithful brethren. What does the word saint mean? What is a saint? Define a saint. All right. Everybody's scared to jump out there, so I'll go ahead and try to define it for you. As near as I understand the scripture, a saint is not, as some quote-unquote Christian religions would have us to believe, these believers who've gone on, they are dearly departed saints, true enough. But some quote-unquote Christian religions would have us to believe that we could pray, for instance, to my father who's now gone on to go before, or we could pray to Paul, or we could pray to Abraham, or we could pray to Mary or whomever, and they would approach God for us. Now, I don't have to pray to them, number one. The Bible says there's one mediator between God and man, men, the man Christ Jesus, who would have all men to be saved. I can approach God in the person of Jesus Christ. That's why we end our prayers in Jesus' name. He's the way that we approach Christ. A saint is simply a saved, baptized member of a local church. That's it. That's the way I understand a saint to be from Scripture. He talks to some people in Scripture, Mrs. Eaton. He says of them, they are called to be saints. Why? Because they were disobedient at the moment. They had a man in the church sleeping with his stepmom, and they weren't saying nothing about it. They weren't saints because they weren't right with God, or they would have had some discipline there. They were called to be saints. A saint's just a saved person. There's a unity there with God. We'll get to the brethren in a minute, but there's a unity there with God. If I am, Christ said twice in John chapter 20, peace be unto you. And we could look back from where we preached over here in Philippians, and he talks about the peace that passes all understanding in chapter 4. That's Ephesians, so that's probably why I can't find that verse in chapter 4. He talks about be careful for nothing, so don't worry about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known unto God, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Then he talks about, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Those things which ye have both learned and received and heard and seen in me, do. And the peace of God shall be with you. And he goes on one more time to say, I've learned to be content or satisfied in whatsoever state I am. And he's writing that from a jail cell where he's waiting to have his head chopped off. Peace. There's two kinds of peace, Ashley. When I got saved, I got peace with God. And we'll get to the peace with our men and, you know, with our fellow believers in a moment. But there's this unity. And, you know, it took me a while to find the verse because he did not read it from a King James Bible, but I did find it. The new president quoted Psalm 133, verse number 1. I sent that out to you in a text this morning. I thought it was very important. Help me, Lord. There it is. Boom. Behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell in unity. It is like a precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard. All throughout the New Testament, guys, we are commanded. We are given peace with God. It's only our job to grab hold of that peace. He's provided it. If we're saved and we don't have peace with God, we just need to, what does the Bible say in 1 John 1? Confess our sins. He's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So he takes away the sin. He takes away the guilty conscience. We have peace with God. But also with the brethren. How many times through these prison epistles have we seen something about one accord, something about one mind, something about one heart? Peace with God and peace with our brothers. All right, that's 30 minutes and now it's preaching time. Do we really have peace with one another? Or do we only have peace with one another when we get our way? It's preaching time. A lot of times we only have peace with one another when they submit to what we want. This has got to be the desire of our peace right there. If I line up with this and you line up with that, hey, this is our peace. My peace has got to be with him. My peace with you cannot be just for the sake of having peace. Our peace has got to be around God's word. Our peace with one another. Our peace with God. Lots of people are sincere, Brother Johnny, but they will sincerely burst hell wide open, as we say in our southern vernacular, if they don't have peace with God. Now, everybody in the room, with few exceptions, I know there's some that haven't reached the age of accountability, and I know there's one other one who has told me that they're not saved and not quite ready to call on Christ, and I'm praying God will work in their life, okay? But for those of us who know that we're saved, we'd all say amen about salvation. Everybody was shaking their head and agreeing what I said about salvation. Everybody's shaking their head and agreeing about what I said about being sent. But it's preaching time. How many of us have given somebody a gospel tract this week? How many of us have found somebody, don't raise your hand. I appreciate that, but don't raise your hand because I want it to be between you and God, all right? How many of us have spent time with our own children trying to teach them the word of God? As I said at the Brotherhood this morning, I'll just go ahead and give you that sermon too since you didn't make it there, amen. It's on dad. Moses said, God gave me the commandment, and I gave it to you, and it's on you to teach your children basically all things I've commanded you. Whether you're getting up, going to bed, walking by the road, I want you to tie it to your hand, tie it to your head, and tie it to the doorpost. Now, Michael David, I don't think he actually wanted them to tie it to their hand and tie it between their eyes, but what I do know he wanted them to do is let our actions be governed by that book. Let our thoughts and our decisions be governed by that book, even when we're at the house. It's on dad. All of us say we agree that. How many of us have, as parents, have spent time this week teaching our children the word of God? You say, well, I'm not a parent. Okay, great. Even for the parents, how many of us have spent time this week telling anybody else what great things Christ has done for us? And with all due respect, I don't mean telling the same two people over and over and over and over. Oswald Chambers has gone on to be with glory, but I like his thought process. He said, should anybody hear twice before everybody's heard once? Man, there's lots of people around here that don't know Christ. Are we truly unified if we wait on the discipleship and the soul winning to only occur at God's house? It's God's people's job to win the lost and to disciple those people we want. The Great Commission was not given to 12 preachers. Actually, there were only 11 at that juncture. The Great Commission was given to above 500 people at one time, the New Testament says. It's on, just like Brother Charles talked about in Sunday school. Because it makes it not only to our mouth, but to our wallets. Not only to our mouth and to our wallets, but our manpower. What are we doing to try to reach the lost? I'm going to shut up now because I think the Lord said to. But I'm telling you, God wants to see the church grow. And if it doesn't grow in numbers, he still wants it. You know, we might be like Jeremiah. I don't know, Brother Johnny, because I can't see the future. I don't have a crystal ball. What do I mean by we might be like Jeremiah? Anybody know what Jeremiah is called? Denise? The weeping prophet. Two people said so. Why was he weeping? Because as far as we know, he never had one single convert. Never had one. As far as we know, Miss Karen, the guy that was his scribe, his secretary that wrote down what we know as the books of Jeremiah and Lamentations, as far as we know, the scribe never even got saved. He tried once, Brother Jerry, to quit. I don't know about y'all, but I've tried to quit a time or two. When everybody's against me, it doesn't seem like anything's going my way. I just tried to quit. Not literally, but I sure wasn't going out and looking for places to preach and people to talk to about the Lord. It's kind of like Jeremiah said, if I'm truly saved, we ought to be able to be like Jeremiah and say, it's a fire shut up in my bones. I tried to quit, but I couldn't quit. I can't understand people who call on Christ and profess to be saved, and then they just quit and go away. Man, I can't look in their hearts, Miss Christie. I don't know if they're really saved or not, but I know that with the struggles that I've had and the struggles I know the Marshalls have had and the struggles I know that y'all have had in another church, in another town, it's easy to see why somebody would quit. But for some reason, a lot of people that are truly saved never quit. So that gives me concern about those other people. But I can't do anything about it. I can't save them. I can't make them come back to church. But I can be secure in my own salvation and know enough of the Word of God that I can disciple my children and speak to the kids at school, speak to my coworkers, and speak to complete strangers about the works of God. And maybe all of us are witnessing. I don't know. But I know this is what the Lord said, preach, so I'm going to shut up. Brother Ashley and Sister Janice can come forward. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you would do what I cannot do, and that's work in the hearts of your people. And Lord, I know that.